Okay, we're going to get started. I'm Dan Rundy. I hold the Schreier Chair here at CSIS, and this is a Chevron Forum. I'm very grateful to my friends at Chevron for their partnership, and this is a part of the series, and they've really helped us to grow what we've been doing here at CSIS, and so I'm really grateful for the partnership, and I think this topic is very appropriate for a Chevron Forum. We've been working at CSIS for a long time about understanding the central role that the private sector plays in development. 9 out of 10 jobs in the developing world are in the private sector. If you care about public sector, public goods, that means you need people to pay taxes. You want people in the formal economy. If you want to deal with the youth bulge and youth employment, you want to have you want to have inclusive private sector-led growth so that you can absorb young people into an economy as they enter a workforce. To have a functioning economy, there's large understanding and acceptance that you need a growing and inclusive private sector. So we've done a lot of work on that over a long period of time. One of the things that I think in the United States we need to do a better job of is understanding and seeing Africa through the lens of as an opportunity. Full stop. See Africa as an opportunity, not through any other lens. I can guarantee you the Chinese look at Africa as an opportunity. They don't look at it through any other lens. Now, we have other lenses, but we have a complex and deep relationship with Africa, but I think we need to put Africa as an opportunity at the front of the line. We can look at Africa through these other lenses, but I think sometimes we've looked at Africa through other lenses, and I think we've got some outdated, I'm going to date myself here, outdated cassette tapes in the United States about how we think about Africa and what's going on. This is not your grandparents' Africa. It's richer, it's freer, it's more capable, it's got a ton more agency, it's gonna double in population, it's gonna be it's a billion people, it's gonna go to more than 2 billion people. The center of gravity of demography in the world is gonna shift to Africa. There's gonna be 400 million young people, huge youth bulge, and I believe young people have fabulous potential energy, and they can be harnessed for good. And that's what, in fancy terms, that's called a demographic dividend, and or not. And so I'll let you guys, connect the dots on what or not means. I'm going with door number one. I'm going with let's go with the demographic dividend. So we need to see Africa in the United States as primarily an opportunity. Senator Coons from Delaware was an Africanist. I said to him, you were an Africanist before Africa was cool. He said, Dan, Africa was always cool. So he corrected me at this Global Development Forum. But he's had for 7 years now in Delaware a conference on Africa as an opportunity. So we have on the panel here folks who have always seen Africa as an opportunity. I'm a little bit late to this conversation, and I want to help bring the Washington policy community to the conclusion that we need to see Africa primarily as an opportunity. So this is part of that conversation. Okay, so I don't think I have to spend a lot of time in introducing everybody here, but I will spend a minute doing this. They're all friends of mine. I've got my friend Mima Nedeljkovic, who runs the Initiative for Global Development, which is a very important organization that helps help us think about development through the lens of the private sector, and has this very impressive group of African business leaders. It just blow your socks off, impressive group. And as I said earlier, this isn't your grandparents' developing world. And one of the parts of the not your grandparents' developing world and not your grandparents' Africa is that you have this enormous cadre of unbelievably impressive, unbelievably changing the world business leaders who are African. And we want to be a part of that. And he is a connector for that. And Mima was an Africanist before Africa was cool, among other things. My friend C.D. Glenn runs the U.S. African Development Foundation, one of the most important parts of the U.S. government that you may or may not have heard of. And USADF, C.D. had a fabulous career at the Peace Corps. He was at what's now PIXERA, but he was also a major player at the Rockefeller Foundation living in Africa. We say here at CSIS, we don't have enough Glynns in our life. We've been very fortunate that CD's spouse was part of a task force we did on forced migration. And so CD is a friend and colleague, but runs this very important, very flexible, very rapid, very connected organization for Africa, and he's going to tell us about that. My friend Heather Culp is seconded to NDPI, which she'll tell you about, but has had a 10-year career at Chevron, and then previously had a prior career in the nonprofit sector. And she's going to talk, and so Chevron has always thought, has been a long-term partner in Africa, and has made Heather available to lead NDPI and seconded to this organization that is not Chevron, but is has connectivity to Chevron. And Heather started as a child prodigy, and that's why she's that's why I said she's had this career and over time. So she started very young. So Ambassador Yansane is the ambassador from Guinea-Conakry. My policy is, if I'm going to have a conversation about Africa and I don't have somebody from the continent on the panel, I'm just not going to do events. That's my first point. But second, Ambassador Yansane is a wonderful representative for his country. And Ambassador Yansane is really, I think, is going to tell you about the great potential of his country. And I think by understanding the great potential of his country, we'll understand the great potential for our for the conversation that we're going to be having. There's also one point I want to make, is that the U.S. government, to its great credit, under Secretary Wilbur Ross, is leading a delegation of business leaders. Now, we're going to come up with a better term than PAC DBIA, which we need like a more marketing term for this, but this is a government term. But basically, it's a series of business leaders who are going with Secretary Ross to help Secretary Ross to find business opportunities in Africa. And I think that's in the next 2 weeks. I think we'll hear a little bit about that in this conversation as well. Okay. I generally don't talk this much at my own events, if you've been to my events, but I thought it was important to give a little bit of context. Okay. So let me start. So Mima, I blame you for this conversation. So why are we having this discussion? Go ahead.
Thanks for the blame, Dan, and thanks for bringing us all around. Why we have this discussion, you know, we've been speaking about the private sector for years from this side of the ocean. I think the important part now is that finally there's a very vibrant private sector on the other side of the ocean. And the key that in the discussion is that we're not forgetting that. We that preached private sector 30 years ago are now forgetting that actually that private sector in the African continent really has taken root, really it has matured, that we do have African business partners now to be able to be doing business with. And that is really why the sort of round trip discussion has come back 30 years later that I had 30 years ago at African Development Bank.
Can I just interrupt you for a second? How many billionaires are there in Africa? Self-made African billionaires.
I mean, there's over 30. I mean, you know, if you look at the Forbes 500.
So just so we're all on the same page, there's a ton of self-made, rich African business leaders, right? Is that a fair statement?
Fair statement.
Okay, absolutely. So that's in line with what you're talking about.
But even more important is, for every one of the billionaires, there are hundreds, there are thousands of SMEs growing. The aspiring S's, what we call them. And the M's, the middle. So those are the big growing, everybody knows the Dangotes of the world. But what we don't know are the thousands, the tens of thousands that are in those businesses that are growing businesses, aspiring businesses, and much of it really led by the heavy urbanization, the growth, the dividend you were speaking about. You know, for IGD, for the Initial Global Development, the key is to get that African business voice with our American partners in the discussion. We're the solutions conceived by the private sector to development. When we speak of agro-industry, for example, and the other day I was, in fact, in the same room, I think, on the discussion agro-industry, there's all the technical, there's no question, you gotta get better seeds, gotta get better inputs, fertilizer, you know, the financing, you can go on and on, the scroll of obstacles. The key is, who are the solution providers of the obstacles? It's gonna be the private sector, it's gonna be industry. Somebody's gonna take all those problems and say, you know what? Well, here's my solution to that problem, and here's the business that grows out of solving your problem. That is what is happening over and over. That's what that Frontier 100 that you met with are all folks that are taking problems, turn around, and making them solutions. And the solution is then the business. So we're not building projects. You know, it's one of the things I stopped using the term project, because a project is a beginning and end. A business is a beginning. The only end is it's either grown, acquired, or failed. But, you know, it's a business. It has its life of its own. It's not time projectized. That's the key. So how do we get into that? That is the core. That's the connective tissue you're speaking about, that we really, really try to get involved with IGD. And that's what we discuss. That's what our forums are. That's what Frontier 100 is. That is really why we work so closely, you know, with PIN when we get into the discussion with NDPI, with Chevron, with the Rockefeller Foundation. C.D. Glenn had been to Rockefeller. Yeah. You know, this has been, but for us, an absolutely critical kind of media topic.
Okay, so Mima, I do a lot of roundtables, and I do a lot of public events. If you're on my mailing list, I know you get a lot of emails from me. Sorry about that, but we do a lot of stuff here. But I'd say I did 60 roundtables, off the record roundtables last year. The one that sticks out in my mind is the lunch that you brought, where you brought these African businesses. Just tell that story, please.
So we had about a dozen or 15 of the leaders here at that time for one of our Frontier 100 events, mixed in one of your breakfast room or luncheon room, I guess it was, with a number of American business people. And naturally, it's Washington, so a lot of policy people. And I believe that one of the questions towards the end was a policy person asking this, not a business person. And the question was, well, with all the difficulties and the conflicts and the various things in the continent, how do we convince American business to look at business opportunities in Africa? And of course, it had to be a Nigerian business leader that very quickly they had shut up. Says, well, you know what? Let me pose it differently. The simple answer is, we don't have to convince you. That's not why we're here. We're here to tell you what we're doing, what the opportunities are, what businesses we're in. You want to join us on the ride? Join us. The train is leaving the station. In fact, there are more flights headed Dubai and east than there are flights headed north to Europe and west. So the answer is in your own question. If you're interested, come on. If you're not, we're off and running without you. That's the mature sector 30 years later. We pressed for it 30 years ago. We forgot. Now that we have the results, we're ignoring it. We're still going back with old solutions. Let's go back with business.
Amen. I'm with you. Thank you. Thanks, Mima. Okay, CD. So you've had this fabulous career in the social sector. You were at Pixera. You were at Peace Corps. You were in Africa in the Rockefeller Foundation. You now run. You're the president of the U.S. African Development Foundation, which is a public. It's a U.S. government entity. Tell us about USADF. You have a number of ways that this audience needs to understand how you connect to this, and you actually have a very critical role in sort of helping enable a new kind of a conversation to happen in Africa for the United States.
Thanks, Dan. Thanks for your friendship. Thanks for your leadership here at CSIS. This is a great event to be a part of. Africa as an opportunity, let's use Dan's words. So if Africa is an opportunity, the U.S. African Development Foundation is in the opportunity creation business. We fund, we find, we invest in African-run, African-managed, African-owned enterprises, community enterprises, social enterprises. If you talk about trade and investment, if you talk about grassroots development, if you're talking about how are we having this conversation around Africa as an opportunity, we're in the business of creating those opportunities, providing seed capital directly to African organizations, linking them with local technical assistance, and then putting them on a pathway to prosperity. It's government. It's a government agency, so it's the best kept secret in government, and we no longer want it to be a secret, which is why I'm on stage and we're talking proudly about what we do. But why did we come about? Because there was sort of a gap in how the U.S. government looks at development, looks at trade and investments, looks at sort of economic development in Africa. And so 20 years after the creation of USAID, a number of people on Capitol Hill, Senator Ted Kennedy, Representative Bill Gray, a number of leaders sort of said, you know, Africa is the land of opportunity. There's a lot that needs to happen, but we also need to make sure that Africans have a voice and a choice in their own development. And so instead of looking at development being top down, what if it were bottom up? Instead of looking at Africa as a land where expats go to provide assistance, what about local actors providing technical assistance and business acumen to African enterprises? And instead of just looking for these islands of opportunity or cherry picking the winners, how do we make sure that development in Africa is more inclusive? So let's go to the places of greatest need. Let's serve the people and the populations that have the greatest challenge, but let's ask them, what those challenges are. Let's invest in these Africans, their ideas, their solutions, and look at enterprise creation for poverty alleviation. Let's really look at the power of creating local business to really create the opportunity to meet these local challenges. And that's why we've been around for 30 plus years, really focusing at the grassroots, directly investing in local communities, and really creating a vibrant grassroots local economic sector that leads to, as Mima said, an African SME, an African small and medium-sized enterprise sector that can be the opportunity not only to provide goods and services here to the U.S., so the coffee producers that we work with that are now selling into Starbucks, the cashew producers that are now sort of funding and creating opportunities for Whole Foods and Costco, those cashews that you buy in Costco, by the bag, coming from Beninese producers that we support. So these linkages of really creating local African private sector that is able to link to U.S. private sector, that's why we're in this opportunity creation business. And we're really proud of the unique role that we play because our funding is specialized funding. I mean, we invest directly into African organizations. We meet their demands. We help them grow and prosper. And their opportunities to really create better lives and better livelihoods for their communities leads to so many things. It leads to trade and investment. But Dan hinted at this. It also leads to peace, security, economic stability in really unique ways. Let me give you one quick example on this. It's an extreme example, but it's important. So, and we all know Somalia, and we know, and let me say this, ADF, we work in those tough places. So we're in the Horn, we're in the Sahel, we're in the Great Lakes region, we're in northern Nigeria, where I actually used to live when I worked with the IFC. We're in, you know, places like Niger, and we're in places like Somalia and Burundi. Ambassador Moeller here, who was the former ambassador to Burundi, who knows our work there on the ground. But let me go to Somalia. So Somalia, a country that we all know for various reasons, they're able, Al-Shabaab, a terrorist group, is able to recruit a young person to join Al-Shabaab with the promise of $50 a month and a cell phone. $50 a month and a cell phone, you'll join Al-Shabaab. You'll strap on a suicide vest, you'll carry an M16, you'll put your life on the line, and you'll kill and murder plenty of innocent people. And I lived in Kenya, as Dan said, and was in Nairobi during the Westgate attack that happened there. But these young people in Somalia, with no hope, with very limited opportunities, sort of look at $50 a month and a cell phone and say, you know what, it's better than nothing. We have a program in Somalia where we train, where we place, where we really equip young people to start their own businesses, link them to businesses, and give them a real opportunity, bringing hope and bring economic prosperity to these same young people who would be recruited by Al-Shabaab. That program, now the graduates of that program get placed into jobs, and those young people are able to earn upwards of $300 a month. By creating a business, by being linked to businesses, by having real enterprise in their lives, becoming entrepreneurs. And so it's a direct trade-off. Business development in Africa as an opportunity for U.S. business, but business development in Africa so that Africans can trade and invest with each other. It's more than just doing business. It's actually the opportunity for us to really help catalyze the continent in a way that leads to local economic development. And so the work we do, we think, is vitally important to the conversation about private sector-led growth, but it's also locally-led growth and development that we're focused on.
Okay, so CD, two questions for you. One is, you can make grants, but you have very, very flexible money, and you can do other things with it. Talk about that, but there's one other thing. There's this PAC-DBIA trip coming up that we'll hear a little bit more about, but I think one of the things, talk about the PAC-DBIA trip, but you were talking earlier, in some ways you have the golden Rolodex in Africa on any number of different industry sectors. Talk about, for example, just the renewable energy sector, how many organizations you know that you guys have a direct relationship that are in the for-profit renewable energy sector.
So the role of ADF in terms of our seed capital, our technical assistance, this is catalytic grant capital. This is startup fund. This is funding directly going into African enterprises to fill a key gap. And that money is really unique because it's important that you do have an OPIC and that you have a USAID and that you have other entities that are providing different types of funding. But to be able to sort of look at de-risking capital, to sort of put money down into early stage African enterprises, it's really needed. These are market access and access to financing are real key challenges for business growth. So to be able to use grant capital, Dan, to invest directly into African enterprises, but also to use capital to really bring those same enterprises more than money, to bring them management support, to bring them real project monitoring support, to bring them mentorship, how to be a small and growing business. That's also what we bring. And we use Africans to link to our African investments. And so our money is very fungible, it's agile, it's direct, it's demand responsive. And so we do look at this as catalytic de-risking capital beyond your mother's sort of grant making, if you will. Now, this trip, that you keep hearing this acronym, Dan is saying, PACDBIA, this is the President's Advisory Council for Doing Business in Africa, established by President Obama and now carried over by President Trump. And this, and there's a trip that's coming up, as was alluded to. Secretary Wilbur Ross in the Department of Commerce is leading a trip of American business leaders. I mean, they're captains of industry who are going over 20 plus to Africa for 10 days. 10 days, business leaders in Africa, four countries, Ethiopia, Kenya, Cote d'Ivoire, and Ghana. And they're going to look at deal making, deal sourcing, and really look at Africa as an economic opportunity, Africa as a business opportunity. We're fortunate at the U.S. African Development Foundation to be one of the U.S. government agencies that is also going on that trip. And our role is pretty unique because the American businesses want to do business in Africa, and when you're doing business in Africa, you need to do business with what? With who? With African businesses. So this Rolodex that Dan talks about, these are investments that, you know, ADF 10 years ago started with cooperatives or small scale enterprises that are now leading captains of industries in different markets in Africa. And so we have the opportunity to link some of our past investments, some of our current investments to American businesses to tell them who are the potential joint venture partners for you. Where should we really look at opportunities for greater synergies between American business and African businesses? But also, who's trying to buy some of the goods and services that American businesses produce? African entrepreneurs need technology, they need equipment, they need a lot of the things that American companies can produce. And so those opportunities to look at the challenges and the opportunities that African businesses have and how American businesses can link to them to make greater economic prosperity for all is really important to us. In the renewable energy space, we work with a number of partners, but we work with GE, for instance. So GE in Africa is doing a lot of big projects, but they also are, you know, at their core, to some extent, they also still have a real space in energy. Renewable energy in Africa is not a nice to do, it's a necessity. 600 million people without access to energy, no power. They're using batteries, they're using candles, they're using kerosene, they're using diesel. They're paying for energy access, but they're not getting what they're really paying for in terms of sustainable, real energy that can be consumptive so they can light their households, but productive so that they can grow their enterprises, agriculture and other ones. We have a program, an off-grid energy challenge, where we focus on funding African energy entrepreneurs. These are Africans who are coming up with renewable energy solutions in wind, water, so solar, hydro, any number of renewable energy sources. And we say, we want Africans to create these energy businesses, doing mini grids, doing any number of things, and we want to invest in them and link them to follow-on funding. With GE support, with our own investment, with others coming on board, we now have a portfolio of over 70, 100% African-owned and operated energy entrepreneurs that are linking to American companies, and GE and others are supporting that. It's almost a $10 million portfolio in African energy entrepreneurs.
So you have a Rolodex. So if someone says, I want to work in the renewable energy sector in Africa, I say, okay, which of these 70 do you want to talk to?
That literally, which market, which kind of business, what are we looking, what are you looking to do? Or you have some kind of technology that you, as an American business, that you also, you know, need to buy and sell. Because you talked about this earlier, Dan, the competition is fierce. There are other people in Africa working with our same entrepreneurs, selling them, you know, solar panels and selling them batteries, and they're not from the US. They're from China or they're from different countries, and the quality is challenging. the timing, you know, is challenging. And so these are opportunities because Africans now are growing businesses and they want to do real business. And America needs to wake up and be real partners with these African entrepreneurs.
Okay, they need to wake up and drink that Rwandan coffee. That's what I'm saying. Okay, thank you. Okay, so Heather, thanks for being here. So Chevron has been a long-term partner in Africa, has been there for decades. And when Chevron goes into a country, its operating paradigm is partnership, partnership with the community, partnership with people, partner with governments, and takes a very long-term view across the society. You guys are oftentimes, you're often a major employer, you're a major taxpayer in a country, and you also buy and source lots of things in a country in addition to in terms of supply chains, et cetera. So, and then you've also done, and now you're involved, in addition to all that, there's a social investment component to what you do. And so one of the major social innovations that Chevron's been involved with is something called NDPI. So talk about Chevron and talk about NDPI and how you fit into this and how Chevron fits into this conversation.
Thank you, Dan. Thanks for allowing us to be here and speak today, especially on a panel with such great thought leaders, almost all of whom are already our partners, by the way. So I think that's going to be one of the themes of what I'm going to talk about, which is partnership. Chevron's been operating in the Niger Delta for over 75 years, and the challenges in the Delta are obviously complex. And after developing a pretty good participatory development model for a lot of the host communities, there was a recognition, though, that the issues in the Delta were much wider than what was just happening in our host communities, and that we needed to step back and think about a way to get at some of the root causes of violence and instability in the Delta. And so out of that idea was born the thought, let's do an independent foundation called the Niger Delta Partnership Initiative. That P is very important, the partnership piece, because it was also born out of a recognition that there's no way that one company can do this alone. And so part of looking at how do we figure out ways to create an economic growth model that would be more equitably distributed, how do we look at sectors that have an absorptive capacity for all of, particularly the young people that need economic opportunities in the Delta, and how could we address some of the underlying root causes of conflict that are, yes, related to the economic inopportunities, but also go much deeper than that. And how do we find the right partners? So Chevron put up $50 million on the table and said, right, USAID, DFID, you left the Delta. Would you come back? Would you work with us? Would you help us figure out how to make a lasting contribution to what's going on in the Delta, to think about ways that we could look at the private sector in Africa, in the Niger Delta, that already exists, figure out what inefficiencies are there in the market, and take a very market development approach to figuring out how do we fix these inefficiencies as partners, how do we truly collaborate as donors, and how do we bring the Nigerian businesses in as real partners, right? Not beneficiaries, as partners from the beginning. And that's really the DNA that created the Niger Delta Partnership Initiative. And sort of 9 years later, what I would say is, what we've learned about this thing is that partnership is absolutely the key. Partnership is hard, because we're not talking about, let's give a grant and that's a partner. We're talking about really creating together, sitting down with USAID, with the Fund for Peace, with the US African Development Foundation, with IGD, with USAID, with DFID, with our African partners, and saying, how do we co-create something from the beginning that's going to be lasting? You know, 9 years on, we've got 33,000 people whose incomes have been raised over 92% and still counting. We have had a lot of on-the-ground violent conflicts that have been mediated by Nigerians who have helped end the violence. We've had Nigerians who have helped figure out ways to have more peaceful elections in the Niger Delta, particularly around governor elections, which tend to be more violent even than some of the national elections. We have been able to bring in Nigerian companies who see the benefit of working with farmers. For instance, our fish feed partners, one of the reasons that when we first got there, most of the catfish sold in the Niger Delta markets were actually sourced from Lagos and other places. So local fish was too expensive. Now over 95% of the local fish in the Niger Delta markets are produced locally. Why is that? We went to the fish feed companies and said, right, you need to help us help the farmers understand how to do biomass feeding with your fish feed. Why would they get involved? Because they're going to create customers. Why do the farmers get involved? Because they're going to create fish that are larger, that fetch a better price at market. That means that then they're able to have more profits, which they can invest back in more fish feed to grow their farms. And so it's that way, by working with our partners on the ground, and then piloting approaches, and then saying to our partners like USAID, hey, you've got more resources. Now take this approach and scale it up. And that's what they've been doing. So I think that talking about that private sector-led development, you cannot have that conversation unless you're going to talk about how do you make effective on-the-ground partnerships that are truly co-created with both African partners and, where appropriate, you know, international donors, other members of the private sector, and how do you then start to figure out ways to pilot approaches that work and then use those partnerships to scale them up.
Great. Thank you, Heather. Thanks. Ambassador Jensen, I thank you for being here. I was so taken by the conversation we had at breakfast about your country. Talk about the great opportunities that are in your country of Guinea, because I think it's something we don't hear enough about. And I'd like you also to talk specifically about, after you talk about the opportunities in Guinea, talk about the specific ways in which the United States what's at the top of the list for the United States of opportunities for where the United States could be a partner to where Guinea is going? Because I was so taken by the vision that you painted, and I hope you'll paint that picture for us here.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here this morning, and thank you for the invitation. First of all, I would like to give the big picture of Africa. As you said, there are a lot of changes underway in Africa. Democracy is improving. We see a lot of examples in Zimbabwe, in Zambia, in Gambia, in South Africa. All this because the structure of African people is changing. A lot of young people, better educated, connected, who know what is happening in the world. So democracy is in the way. And this is a very important factor for the changes in Africa. Africa will be a one market with the African Free Trade Agreement. It may take time, but we are going there. Our head of state have signed this treaty in March in Kigali, and this will transform Africa in a market of 1.2 billion people right away. In the next 30 years, will be more than 2 billion. Our shortcomings, for me, should be seen as opportunities. We don't have enough infrastructure, enough schools, enough house, enough energy. All these are investment opportunities for everyone. This means that Africa is open for business. US companies are complaining of a Chinese situation in Africa. China is forthcoming. We have problems, and China is proposing solutions, very quick solution. In 5 years, China has been able to build two dams in Guinea to fill the gap of electricity. Like I said, Guinea is the water tower of West Africa. All big rivers of West Africa are coming from Guinea, and Guinea will be able to provide electricity to almost all West African countries. China is helping in that regard. So why should we refuse that? Guinea is open for business. We have the biggest mining opportunities in West Africa. We have today the last untapped iron ore mine in the world worth $20 billion. We had a project with Australia, Rio Tinto, Canada, and this project is still underway. Agriculture, of course, is one of our big opportunities because of the water. So I may say that the sky is the limit for US companies in Guinea, from agriculture to energy to mining. But of course, the model we have today with China is a special model because Chinese are bringing the feasibility studies, they're bringing the money, but also bringing the contractors to build infrastructure. There is not enough transfer of technology. I do believe that this is an area whereby US companies could have supply chain with African companies and then help build the capacity of our SMEs. And this is more sustainable than just bringing infrastructure on the continent. That's why I think that the US has a role to play. Of course, this will depend on the leadership of US companies. You have to change your mindset. You have to see Africa not only as an area where you have Ebola, you have a conflict, but it is a learning process. Changes are on the way. 50 years of independence in Africa, this is nothing. 50 years, it's nothing. Yeah, so people want us to behave as the US or as Canada or as Australia or as Sweden. It's too quick. We have 70% of the people living in rural areas, not educated. But despite that, African economies are the most fast-growing economies in the world, despite the fact that we don't have enough people educated. So if we were to have all these young people well-educated, I'm sure that we could have double-digit growth rate in the next 10 years, and then we could catch up. So the place is open, the race is open, we are open for business, but also for competition. I'm open for responding to any question.
Good, okay. So here's a question that we need to ponder. So I don't know, last 10, let's say 20 years, just for argument's sake. This isn't a precise number, but it's probably in the zip code. The US has probably put $200 billion of foreign assistance in the last 20 years, like $10 billion a year. It's been about $10 billion a year for a long time, so 10, right? So let's say in the last 20 years, maybe the last 30 years, we put $200 billion of assistance into Africa, so $200 billion. So are we good with having dumped $200 billion into Africa and then the Chinese being their number one trading partner? So let me know, are you good with that? I'm not good with that. Like, thumbs down, that's not good, okay? So all this stuff about we need to see, you know, Africa needs to make these reforms, and they've made reforms. Africa needs to democratize, they've democratized. Africa needs to connect with the world, they've opened to the world. So then we kind of like are sort of not gonna be a part of the upside. Are we out of our minds? So we're not gonna be part of the upside of this conversation? This is crazy. This is absolutely crazy. So I'm not good with having put $200 billion into the continent and being a reliable partner for decades. The United States has been a good partner to Africa, but are we gonna choke on the last and on sort of the last inning here? It's crazy. So that's the question I think before us. I don't care if it's a Republican administration, I don't care if it's a Democratic administration. This is the challenge for the next 20 years. The question is, are we gonna choke? And are we gonna let the Chinese waltz off with all the upside? That's the strategic question. There's lots of other strategic questions, and we spend a ton of time on the hard ones, you know, Ebola this and other things, but this, I think, is the one we're missing. I don't care what administration is, and I think we're doing some steps. President Obama has taken some steps, and President Trump has taken some steps. We could do more. So one of the questions for the panelists that I want you all to, I want you to ponder, I'm gonna come back to the panelists at the end of this conversation, is if you were in front of Secretary Ross, or you were in front of Secretary Pompeo, or you were in front of a Senate committee, the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, and they said to you, what's the one thing the United States could do to be a better economic partner to Africa? Like, what fix would you make? What realistic fix? Don't virtue signal, don't pose. Like, what's a realistic thing you could do? That's the question for each of these panels I'm gonna come back to at the end of this. Okay, so I've got a lot of people I wanna hear from. I'm gonna ask for a lot of forgiveness. I've got a couple of ground rules when I do this, okay? I'm gonna ask for your name. I'm gonna ask for your organization. And we're into inclusivity at CSIS. So if you take more than 30 seconds, you're not being inclusive. And you know being inclusive is really important. So if you're not being inclusive, I'm gonna cut you off. So we wanna be inclusive at CSIS. So if you go on and drone, you're taking away from other people, and that's not inclusive, and that's bad. So I'm gonna cut you off. But I'm actually gonna call a number of people, because I know there's a lot of smart people in the room. So put your hands down, because I'm gonna be calling some folks first. So you don't have to, you can yell at me later and be angry at me later. So I know there's some ambassadors in the room. It's important I hear from them. I need to hear from some other smart people who've got a lot to say, who've been in this business a long time, and who pay their mortgage on this stuff. So I want to hear from my friend Rob Mosbacher. I know there's a couple of ambassadors here in the audience. I want to hear from them. And I also wanted to hear from my friend here in the front row as well. So come on, team microphone, get up here, guys. So let me first start with actually my friend Rob Mosbacher over here. And so remember, everyone, we're about being inclusive at CSIS, so we're going to keep it short, right? Okay, Rob, name, organization, keep it short.
Well, I'm Rob Mosbacher. I'm chairman of the board of IGD, and I've had the pleasure of working with most of your panel. The short answer to your question is we need to upgrade our development finance capacity. There's a bill to do that called the Build Act, which would extend authorities to our development agency, OPIC, that would become a new development finance institution with equity authority as well as the traditional debt. Small grant and technical assistance, changing the requirement in terms of American content. So preference is given to Americans, but it's not a requirement. So it's in the Congress, been reported favorably out of House Foreign Affairs, and we're hoping Senate Foreign Relations will mark this up next week and that they can move towards trying to pass it before the August recess. That's very optimistic, but it's possible.
Okay, so I want to just say a couple of things. So Rob Mosbacher is one of the parents, one of the main parents of putting OPIC on steroids. He's the former head of OPIC in the Bush administration, but has been working on these issues for a long time. And if this happens, one of the reasons it'll have happened, success has many parents, but one of the absolute parents to this will be Rob Mosbacher. Rob, thanks for your service. Thanks for what you've been doing in your leadership at IGD, and thanks for all you do. So I hear there are several ambassadors here from African countries. It's ludicrous for us to have this discussion if I don't hear from African ambassadors. So gentlemen, I want to hear from the two of you, and then I also want to hear from my friend in the front row. Okay. Just remember my rule that we want to be inclusive here.
Okay, now I am Carlos Veiga, ambassador of Cape Verde.
You're ambassador of Cape Verde. Thanks for being
here. Yes. And I'm here to learn more than to talk. And I would like to know how you see AFCFTA.
Sorry, what is that?
Continental Free Trade Area.
Okay, so what do you think of the Free Trade Agreement in Africa?
Yes.
I think it's unbelievably important, and I want to hear from the panelists about what they think. And I took a note that said, we got to do some more stuff on that. And I know my friend Flory Leeser, who was at USTR and runs the Corporate Council on Africa, my first thought is I'm going to call Flory Leeser after this and talk to her about this. What I want to hear from the panelists, and I'm going to call on Flory Leeser in a little bit. So, Ambassador.
Good morning. I'm Carlos de Santos. I'm the ambassador of Mozambique. We are both Carlos.
Yeah. Two Carloses.
Yes, yes. No, but the first thing I wanted to say is really to thank you because we come here to discuss conflict most of the time, in Africa.
It's always bad news.
Yes,
it's always
exactly.
bad news.
And today,
it's a big continent, right?
Yes.
54 sub-Saharan African
exactly.
countries, 1.2 billion people.
Exactly.
Now, if you'd go and look at the news in the U.S., outside of the U.S., you'd think everything, there's a shooting every day in the U.S., and so kids,
yes.
they don't want to send people to the United States because there's some shooting going on all the time and people don't want to come here. So
exactly.
it's the same. We have the same unfair press
yes.
outside of the United States as Africa has outside of Africa.
Absolutely, and that's the first answer to your question. Is discussing opportunities in Africa. And the great thing I like about this panel is that they're offering solutions. We're working with IGD, and we want to work with both of your organizations. As you were talking, I was looking at, I was saying, but these are the kinds of organizations that we need. Now, my
remember my inclusivity rule, to
yes.
keep it short.
Yes, I know. My colleague has spoken about the continent. I just wanted to seek a clarification on the foundation. What is the difference in terms of how you select the organizations work with? What do you require to take a decision to work with a partner? And I think we'll have a bilateral one. I would like to know more about
it. Keeping
you.
It inclusive. Thanks a lot. Okay, this woman here, please. Name, organization, keeping it inclusive.
Thank you very much. My name is Toyin Ojora-Saraki. I'm founder of the Wellbeing Foundation Africa, which works in maternal, newborn, and child health. And I'm also the wife of the Senate President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria.
And ma'am, you're not gifted with my big room voice. Speak up, please.
First of all, thank you for the opportunity to address you. I'm really happy to hear about what the USADF is doing and what Chevron is doing. I'm quite familiar with. But my question, and what brought me to America now, is the issue of water insecurity. America has been one of the biggest donors to water infrastructure around the world through USAID. But in Nigeria, my country, who has been a recipient of much of this aid, 69% of health facilities say they conduct deliveries, but only 29% of those health facilities actually have water in a delivery room. So our frontline health workers are unable to wash their hands, and they're
okay.
delivering death.
Keep
I'd
it
like
inclusive.
To know,
Keep it
I'd
inclusive.
I'd like to know how we can work with you to ensure that all this aid you're giving actually reaches the front line to the women and children
okay.
that
thanks
actually
so much.
Count.
Thanks for
Thank
keeping
you.
It inclusive. Thank you. Okay.
So, quick answers, guys. Need you all to just...
You're here. Mima?
You know, I think this the main point here for me is why the opportunities is really all about the big job, the youth bulge. You're doubling population. So the whole thing with IGD is so heavily focused on what do we do with all these youth coming out? That's got to be the employment issue. That's got to be the creation of jobs. That's got to be the creation of those opportunities. And that is why your water issue, if you're going to continue looking for aid to get water, you're going to end up dry, I guarantee you. So we better figure out some way that there is a business solution there that's going to deliver water for people that are happy to pay for clean water just as they're happy to pay for power.
Okay, Africa free trade thing, is that a real thing?
The free trade piece for me, I mean, it's very important, it's large, but it has to be implemented. I mean, here I'm going to speak as an old African, I'll take my IGD hat off. You know, we have to be able to truly move product and service across borders. It's not more photo ops, and I keep saying running out of capitals to do, you know, the memorandums of, including one from Maputo. Let us start implementing what we got. So you have RECs, let's get those working well. Let's then get the RECs into the full continental piece. Because the business in the end has to scale, therefore must have big markets, but the markets must really be truly borderless.
Okay, CD.
Okay, the inclusive rule.
Yep.
So at ADF, I mean, we were designed to do development differently. And so to answer some of the questions around how we partner, who we work with, how we make sure that we're reaching those most in need, I look at this from saying that ADF is a partner of choice for communities. So we fund directly into grassroots communities, giving that funding directly, ma'am, to the women, children, youth, smallholder farmers, pastoralists, refugees directly, mm-hmm. partner of choice for communities, partner of choice for countries. Countries, as we're in 20 plus countries right now with operations there, our local staff, I have a staff of about 40 people here in Washington. We have no expats on the ground. Only one of the only U.S. government agencies that works in foreign assistance, all of our partners on the ground are African organizations, and countries actually, some countries co-invest in the U.S. African Development Foundations. I put $1 million down, $2 million down in small grant financing. The government of Uganda, the government of Benin, the government of Malawi co-invest with the U.S. government to reach those grassroots communities. So we're a partner of choice for countries. So if Mozambique wants to be a partner with the African Development Foundation, we can definitely talk about how we could collaborate to jointly work together.
Okay, Heather.
So I think that water question is spot on, and I'll go back to the idea of, again, partnership and a private sector-led approach. So we've been partnering with UNICEF and Rotary International to figure out a way to approach local entrepreneurs in the Niger Delta to buy and then sell biosand filters for schools and communities in the riverine areas, particularly in the Delta, which have, you know, as we all know, huge water issues, despite being surrounded by water. And so I would say, just as Mima was talking about, figuring out ways to harness private sector entrepreneurs to provide that to us is going to be the way to create sustainable solutions versus just looking at it as continually an aid model, right? Who are the people who are going to make money out of it? And they're the people that are going to continue it. And so that's the way that we've approached it, at least in the riverine communities in the Delta.
Ambassador Yansani.
Yeah, two comments. One on communities. I think that when companies are working in local communities, we need to empower women and youth to ensure that everyone is informed about what's going on. And this could perhaps, from my point of view, boost inclusivity. Otherwise, we may have just a limited number of people benefiting from, you know, the proceeds of mining companies or oil companies. So transparency, participation, and sustainability are key. When it comes to African free trade area, I think that the U.S. should see this as an opportunity to open up Africa as one single market and refrain from trying to build bilateral agreement with a limited number of countries and trying to put constraint for Africa to become a single market. If Africa is a single market, for me, this opens big opportunities for US companies to work all over Africa. But if you decide to have only bilateral agreement with limited number of countries, you may end up, you know, be seen as trying to antagonize our regional integration process.
So we're going to have to watch out for how we do trade agreements going forward, given all of that. Okay, got it. Okay, so I want to hear from Ambassador Mueller. I want to hear from Flory Leeser. I want to hear from my buddy at GMU, whose books I buy retail, and I want to hear from my friend at the Tony Blair Initiative, okay? So team microphones, come over here. So Ambassador Mueller's here, Flory Leeser's there. Let's start with Flory Leeser. Flory, you got the microphone.
Just very quickly, Africa accounts today for only 3% of all world trade, which seems incredibly ridiculous given all of the resources it has. The main factor that will go into changing that for Africa is investment both by African companies, large and small, US companies, large and small, and others from around the world into Africa's productive capacity, value-added products, and various key sectors that are so important for economic development.
Okay. And Flory Leeser, you're the president of the Corporate Council on Africa, and you had a fabulous career at the U.S. Trade Representative's Office in Public Service. Thanks. Okay. Ambassador Mueller.
I pick up on Mima's point about the youth bulge in Africa. I was on a Harvard panel about a year ago, and I called the unemployed youth of Africa unexploded ordnance.
Totally agree. I associate myself with that.
It is a brilliant place to begin transformative change. I'm also a happy veteran of USADF and the way they deliver that which is needed by small and medium enterprises. It goes right to the entrepreneur when the entrepreneur presents a reason for it to come. And it goes quickly, and it provides a spark in an economic community that grows and burgeons and affects other parts of the community. It's really one of my favorite business models.
Fabulous, Ambassador, keeping it inclusive.
And let me say that really, those are my principal points.
Fabulous. I love it. I love it. I'm taking the unexploded ordinance for good or for ill. Like I said, this is kinetic energy of great, great force. Okay, my friend, GMU. I read buy all his books retail.
Thanks a lot, Dan. Phil Auerswald, George Mason University, Global Entrepreneurship Network. Love what I've heard so far this morning. I wanted to focus on a specific part of the entrepreneurial ecosystem, which is scale-up funding and scale-up support, mentorship, the entire ecosystem, around in-country services, 0 to 50 million growth, or 1 to 50 million growth stage. So we've had an explosion of startup stuff, the 0 to a million, and infrastructure at over 50 million, obviously everything in resources over 50 million, there's financing there. But I'm really interested in in-country services, health, transport, across the board, consumer services. How are we going to grow those markets, since that is, you know, the opportunity for the 21st century?
The Blair Initiative.
Jonathan Zaid, yes, from the Tony Blair Initiative. Thank you, Dan. Agree with private sector-led growth. That's my background. That's where I'm coming from. But there's something we haven't talked about, which is the enabling environment and the role of governments in Africa to shape, to be facilitators and enable that. Governments in Africa, we work with 14 of them, are yearning for that transformative change that will address the youth bulge, but they are not getting the right type of support that allows them to drive their own agenda into place to create jobs in manufacturing, agriculture, etc. So I think something we need to focus on maybe next time is how to get the right type of support to governments where they need it.
Okay, great, good, okay.
Let's go down the panel. Nima? You know, I'll go right, I'm gonna tie them all together. I mean, the whole point of government is very, very critical because the interests are fully aligned. About a year ago, I think, in Durban, we did the Frontier 100 Forum was focused on youth unemployment and how do you keep I love that, thank you, Patricia, unexploded ordinance from blowing up. And that is really where the interests align, because in the end, in the environment, the business
leaders— We're blowing up the right way and get into business, right?
That's the key. The business leader said, if you don't give us the environment to grow and create jobs, the streets blow up. Well, guess what? When the streets blow up, it's your problem. It's not our problem.
Right.
So that's why our interests are fully, fully aligned. That's one most important thing. And where do you go with that to tie into the other area? I think the big sector that, you know, Flory alluded to and worked very closely with CCA, and I really enjoy that relationship, is agro-industry. We were yesterday, the day before here. I don't even want to hear the term agriculture. It's agro-business, agro-industry. It's value addition. It's where we're working very close with the African Development Bank to show the youth.
Not your grandparents developing world, not your grandparents Africa, not your grandparents agriculture in Africa, right?
Listen to our podcast, and I see George over there. Agriculture is not your grandmother's business, it's agro-industry. That's what it's all about. The youth will come into that, they will get now 1,500 naira versus 1,000 naira to go blow themselves up. Of course then you're gonna go to PIN. What did we find out with the change actors in the Niger Delta? If they get a proper income, they'd rather, who wants to blow themselves up? Of course I'd rather earn 1,500 naira and not blow myself up. I mean, that's the simple answer.
Okay, CD.
Local economic development from startup to scale up, from grassroots to SMEs and beyond. The conversation really is about greater coordination and looking at a continuum of capital. Really being surgical in how we look at the different kind of financing vehicles that a grassroots organization, a community enterprise, a social enterprise, a hardcore business the kind of capital they need to grow, and being more intentional about that. So at the U.S. African Development Foundation, we play a very specific role in the continuum of capital with grant financing and local technical assistance. We make investments, and we call them investments, as grant financing, investments of $250,000 and below, if you will. But what more and more, as we're growing these enterprises, we're asking ourselves, to your point, we're sort of saying our success isn't necessarily the level of investment that we're making into that community enterprise, into that social entrepreneur. It's where do they go after. Every college on the planet predicates their success on where their graduates go and how much money they make. So where do our grantees, our community organizations, where do they go after our $250,000, and how do we prepare them for debt, for equity, for real financing, so that they can capture $1 million in debt or equity or what have you. And so that's really important for us, is this continuum of capital and the growth cycle of organizations.
Okay, Heather.
Yeah, I would just echo, there are 32 million people in the Niger Delta, two-thirds of which today are youth, and that's just growing. And you know, two-thirds of those youth do not currently have productive economic opportunities, right? So how do we fix that? And that is exactly what we're focused on. I totally agree. I mean, the youth of Africa is going to be absolutely the driver of, I think, very positive change, but we need to be on that train with them, right? And I think that that's part of what we're talking about. In terms of the scaling up and the service providers, we work with a lot of service providers. I totally agree that's the way to go. And just like CD was talking about, though, figuring out that 500,000 to sort of 10 million, how do we get that financing? And I was just in Europe last week having this exact conversation with some donors. It's like, how do you figure that out? And I won't promise that I've got any answers yet, but I think what I am at least encouraged is that, like CD, like you, I mean, we're having this conversation, and we will start to figure this out, because absolutely you're not going to scale in Africa until you can fix that sort of missing middle. Everybody's falling over themselves funding the same projects at the 10 million plus range, right? We've got that. We've got the microcredit. It's that missing middle, and I just, we need more of that conversation. Okay. Until we figure it out.
Okay, Ambassador.
I think that development is about partnership. Partnership between government, private sector, civil society, and communities. The government has to make sure that the environment is conducive for investment. Regulatory framework, predictability, justice, contract performance, and so on. But the private sector also should have the corporate social responsibility to be seen as part of the landscape. Otherwise, there may be frustration. This morning, I talked about the area of gold mine in the north of Guinea, whereby the company was providing electricity to communities, but at the same time, not building enough infrastructure. Roads were not there, schools were not there. So finally, we had to talk to the private sector to make sure that gold was digged in an area that was very poor. We have to make sure that the people there, the community there, feel part of the system. Otherwise, there could be, you know, frustration.
So, Ambassador, your country was the Saudi Arabia of bananas 50 years ago. You guys could be the Saudi Arabia of, should be the Saudi Arabia of hydropower in West Africa. You guys have fabulous mountains, you have fabulous beaches. You could quadruple agricultural production if you had the right private sector investment in your country. Is that all true?
It's true, provide that capacity is there. You know, the government plays its role, but also partners come in to help with expertise and financial resources, and working with communities and building supply chain with local private sector.
Okay, so Ambassador, I have one simple question. China is already there and sees this vision. Is that true?
China is there, but in a particular aspect of the country. China is building infrastructure for Guinea, roads.
I think they're eating our cashew nuts and drinking our Yirgacheffe coffee. That's what I think. Is that a fair statement, Ambassador?
No, I think it's not a joke. You know, no, China is very serious about Africa.
And China, and we've got to follow. We've got to take a cue from the Chinese.
China is now in demographic transition, and China has started to outsource its own industry in Africa. Ethiopia is one example of China building big industrial unit for textile to export to the world, to Europe and to US, because Chinese situation is changing. The wage are increasing, environment is no more conducive, there are a lot of pollution in Africa. So they are trying to shift the industry to Africa. But of course, we have to make sure that this industry are clean and not polluting.
Okay, Ambassador, so if you were with President Trump in the Oval Office, what's your one piece of advice you would give? So let me go now to this question. So Ambassador, what is your piece of advice to President Trump as he thinks about Africa as an opportunity? What's the one or two easy things the United States could do? What are those?
How to change the mindset and to see Africa not only in a place for conflict or disease, but an area that will be the last frontier for development. And this will be in the interest of Africa as well as the US.
So I completely agree with you. Thank you, Ambassador. Okay, Heather, so if you were with President Trump in the Oval Office or you were in front of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee on a panel and they asked you that question, what's your answer to that?
We've talked a lot about seeing Africa as an opportunity, but I think also talking about Africa as an opportunity, encouraging businesses to look, American businesses to look at Africa as an opportunity.
Okay, CD.
Provide greater direct funding, greater funding to the U.S. African Development Foundation.
Yes, I was going to say, so double that, the USADF budget.
So that we can continue to make the direct investments in Africans for local economic development. We're combating the challenges of food insecurity, energy poverty, youth unemployment on the ground in the communities directly to Africans. Scale us up 10x.
Amen. Amen. Okay, so Mima, so we've talked about putting OPIC on steroids, plussing up, I'll put that in quotes, somewhere between 2x and 10x, depending on who the speaker was, the USADF. What else should we be doing? What, if you were in front of President Trump in the Oval Office, you were in front of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee testifying, what are three or four simple, realistic things we could do?
Very quick. I mean, I'll bounce right off Ambassador Yonsa. The change the narrative, I mean, IGD swims in that water. We're all about changing that narrative. That's what we did this U.S. Roadshow. It's recognizing that there is real business people. There's real business opportunity. Chinese see it. Why we don't see it? Come back to what you're saying. That's the most important thing. There is a mature African business sector there now that is a partner to American business wanting to go out. That's the main thing. Two, seek the partners. You know, Africans, yes, we want suppliers, we want providers, we want trade. But you know what? We really need partners. You need to build together. It's not just selling. It's building. Three, the Exim. I mean, you got to.
So U.S. Exim Bank, fix our boo-boos on that? Can we get that done?
You know, you everybody
so
else
there's
is
some kind of
ECA?
Funny virtue signaling. There's something where they've put names forward but kind of not put names forward or something like this. And so we don't have a functioning Exim Bank, which means we can only provide up to $10 million of guarantees. China's Exim Bank is doing $100 billion, so we can do $10 million or $100 billion. We can choose. So we don't we want to fix that? So you're in agreement we should fix that, right?
It has to be. You guys know the politics much better than I do, but the one important thing I hear from the other side also is that it's not just about the big boys and the big companies and Exim. They've found their own solutions. It's those growing SMEs. They need the Exim.
The Exim Bank is not just for big companies. It's for U.S. SMEs.
Correcto.
Okay.
And finish pushing those steroids, Rob, please, into OPIC.
Finish getting the steroids into OPIC and get that done. Okay. Please join me in thanking the panel. I couldn't get to everybody. I'm sorry. But please join me in thanking the panel.